In the last episode, we showed you the 300 test. Now, not everyone took the 300 test on the original project, and you might not be ready for it either. In this episode, we're going to talk about training and progression, which is something that's constant in our gym, and it's something that you should maintain in your training as well. So now we're going to demonstrate some of the fundamental movements, and these are building blocks to more complex movements and also stepping stones for you to take on the way to your own goals. Everything we teach is simple. The movements and the dietary rules become more or less effective according to your commitment. And that's what this really comes down to. It's you and what you're willing to do in order to achieve your goals. So to understand and map out the process of reaching those goals, we always begin by defining the objective. The more accurate the definition, the more precisely we can plan. In the context of a movie project, although it actually applies to everything, by defining the outcome from an aesthetic and a functional point of view, we begin to understand how each individual must prepare. Therefore, to me, when someone says functional fitness, I think that means it's the mental and physical condition that allows the trainee to achieve the objective. It means that the training methods we use and the lessons that we teach must be transferable to the actual task. And Ellie and Haley are going to help me demonstrate the proper techniques for some of these very effective exercises that will help you build a better foundation of fitness. The squat is a fundamental movement. It's something we learned to do when we were kids, and I like to treat it as play. It's the basis for other weighted movements that we'll need to do as the program develops. In order to find the proper position, I like to jump up and down so that my feet, when I land, are roughly shoulder width apart. Toes can be pointed slightly out, but not more than 30 degrees. And then I'm going to just drop to the ground using my arms as a counterbalance to keep myself from falling over backwards. And the most important thing here is going to be depth. So I want to see hips all the way down to below knee level before coming all the way back up to full extension. That means your thighs are, you know, parallel to the floor or below. Do a few. And you can see here that in Ellie's position, his hips are well below the knee, but he's not collapsed onto his calves. So for the squat, your weight should be on your heels or to the midfoot, but never on the toe. In order to execute the squat, you're just gonna think hips back, hips back, hips back, and arms go out to counterbalance. One thing to think about here will be to keep your torso as upright as possible so that you're not folding forwards, but staying here by engaging the core musculature and keeping your eyes on a horizon line, even if you have to imagine it. This is the bear crawl. It's a nice whole body movement, and it's something that we all learned when we were kids, so this movement should take us back to a time when exercise was play. One natural tendency with the bear crawl will be to do the movement with your hips higher in the air to reduce the stress on your core. So if you find yourself with your hips up in the air like an Ellie here, the corrective procedure will be to lower the hips into this position in order to increase the stress and make the movement more effective. The goal of the broad jump is to cover the maximum horizontal distance possible. It's a hip-driven movement, so it's going to start with a counter movement of the hips and the arms, and once you cock that spring, you release and fire to cover that distance. The distance that you can cover completely depends on how you cock the spring with that counter movement and then launch. So the continuous broad jump is more of a cardiovascular effort, and the point here is going to be to string together as many jumps as possible in order to increase oxygen debt. When we lunge, I like to do walking lunges because it's a bit more difficult. It requires more balance, but I also think it's more transferable, so it has a more natural feel to it. To lunge, you're going to simply take a longish stride forward, drop straight down until the trailing knee is gently touching the floor. This knee should not pass in front of the toes here. Arms are where you want them for balance. Your torso is upright to feel a good stretch here. Stand, balance, and then move on. These can be strung together in a fluid way, but you can pause if you need to adjust your balance. Keep your eyes on the horizon in front. Stand. drop until it just gently kisses the ground, but without resting that knee on the ground. And come all the way up and balance. So with a lunge, it's important to remember a couple of details. The trailing knee is going to be lowered to the floor until it gently touches before coming back up. Then the knee on the leading leg is not going to pass in front of the toes in the front. That's important. The shin should be vertical. Finally, keep your torso as upright as possible. You should feel a stretch here in the hip of the trailing leg before you stand, balance, and move on. Different individuals are going to take different length strides, and whether you take a long stride or a short one, it doesn't matter as long as you maintain the proper form. So the trailing knee should stay, just gently kiss the ground. The leading knee should not pass in front of the toes. The shin of the leading leg should be more or less vertical. The torso should stay as upright as can be to get a stretch in the hip of the trailing leg.
The lunge, it targets different musculature than, say, the squat does. It requires more balance, especially in its walking variant, and it's more natural locomotive-wise, making it more transferable to walking and running.
So that's all for now. In the next episode, we'll continue learning more movements.